I'm Morgan Ray.
And I'm Jocelyn Quinn.
Oh, I'm sorry, stop. Let's start over. Let me have someone here take time. Let's Ms. Pickering, can you take a time, please?
That's fine.
And just give
6:21 is the deadline.
And if you can just tell, each team has 7 minutes, so just tell them, you know, just say 6 minutes, 5 minutes, 4 minutes, like that, okay?
Okay, so starting.
Starting now.
Okay. Hello. We're team one. I'm Morgan Ray.
And I'm Jocelyn Quinn.
And we have a third year member. Her name is Mariana Zuku, but she's taking a final. So we'll begin without her. And we are the Bowie Bulldog Exchange app.
All right, so basically what the Bowie Bulldog Exchange app is a app where students can exchange books and school supplies needed for their classes with other students. So our goal of our company is to create an app that can be duplicated by any school where students can swap, sell, or exchange textbooks, school supplies, and dorm essentials safely on their campus while meeting new people. We would eventually like to offer an on-call tutoring service as a part of our app as well. And then our target demographic for this app will be students and alumni.
And that's our logo for our app.
Okay, so we basically did a couple of surveys, and based off of those surveys, we decided that students would like to have an exchange school app, basically because you pay about $100 to $200 per book if you go to the bookstore. If you try to sell it back, you'll get not even half of that. So for this app, it not only creates a way for students to meet each other, but they can also make money off of their books, and they can also sell their books at whatever price they feel necessary. So it works on both ends. You can either, you're either saving money or you're gaining it.
Okay, so this is our budget. So when we talked about our startup budgets, it was brought to our attention that our startup budget needs to be for the first 3 years, because that's when a business can fail. So our budget was taken from our case study on Barnes & Noble's, specifically their college subsidiary, and we figured that we would probably only make about 10% of their revenues. And not even that. So this is our startup budget. So we broke our startup budget down by 36 months, and we broke it up between our monthly costs and our one-time costs. And it came out to be a total of $387,644. So for monthly costs, we included our employee salaries, our advertising, our insurance, our bank service charges, and then our repairs and maintenance. And since we're at, we figured that we would only need computer equipment, computer software, our licenses, and then our consulting and our professional services as our one-time fees. So then we looked into how we were going to fund our Bowie Bulldog Exchange app. So for our startup cost, we considered crowdfunding. So specifically for, in our case, Fundly, because they had a cheaper fee than the other companies. And we also looked into both personal and small business loans. And then as we get after our initial startup cost to operate our app, we figured that there's some people that do not want ads on the app, so they can pay $10 a month for a subscription. And then we have the transactional fees when somebody purchases something. So we would take 1.5% plus 30 cents. And also we have ads. And we figured when we looked into the ads, for every 1,000 hits on your page, you get about $6. So when we calculated it per month, it's about $180 for people clicking on our ads.
Or ads being clicked on our
page. And so this is a picture of our family. We couldn't get the link to work. So this is our blurb that we have on our page. It says, we are fundraising to create a mobile app that would bring students together on campuses as well as give them an opportunity to make money while they're in school. And then we have the name of it. And then we also have our goal. So since our startup fees for the first 3 years were $366,000, we figured that $400,000 was a good number to start with, because that would leave room just in case we ran into any problems. And that's it.
Did you guys raise any money?
So unfortunately, we didn't raise any money, but we did consult a systems engineer to see if that would be a good...
Again, any group that's talking can expect to have a point deducted from their grade from the presentation.
So we talked to a systems engineer that works for the House of Representatives, and she said that it did sound like a good app, but there were still some things that we would probably have to work out. But it sounded good, but yeah, we didn't raise any of the $400,000.
I actually like the ideas. Like, it's a great idea. Books are really expensive. I don't buy books from the bookstore because they're like you said, $100 to $300.
If you sell it back,
you don't even get 50% of what you paid for. So I really like the idea.
And that was one of the things we found in our survey, that most students refuse to sell it back to the bookstore.
Yeah, because you don't really make no profit.
You never make a profit.
No. So I like the whole app idea. I think it's a great one. And your concept was really good. I like the operational, the startup budget table. That was nice, too, for 36 months. And it was definitely a great idea to have a higher budget to raise than the... on your startup budget table. You're trying to raise $400,000 versus the $300,000, which is a better idea. You always want to raise more than you need.
Yeah, just in case you run into something that we didn't account for.
Right, then you have that money left over to help you out the local. So I really like it. It's a great idea.
Okay, thank you.
I had a couple questions. If you could scroll back to your presentation. I saw in one slide in your deck you had a ad. You said ads were $180, I guess, a month. Was that
number six? Yes.
So
this.
Okay.
You want to
talk? So basically,
what my question is. So the question is, in terms of your ads under costs. You said operational costs, ads. Mm-hmm. Are you talking about ads that you're going to be placing in the school newspaper? Or are you saying these are ads that are going to be on your app?
Ads that are on our app.
And they're going to be generating at least $180 a month, right?
At the very least.
So is that a question? Is that an operational cost or is that a revenue?
It's a revenue.
I'm sorry. You put the wrong thing. It's an operational revenue. So, when we were talking about funding.
And so can you go back to your spreadsheet here in terms of your funding?
Yes.
Or not your funding, but your financials?
Yes.
All right, so you have a startup budget. Where are the revenues that you're going to be generating? Where's that displayed?
I'm sorry, we didn't put that on there. It's
okay, so then this, tell me off the top of your head, how much revenue are you going to be generating per month, and when will you start to generate your revenue?
So for the first year, we wouldn't generate any revenue.
Probably the first 2 years.
Yeah, we wouldn't start getting a revenue until the first year, and it would probably only be like $10,000 because we would be recouping what we put out in in starting the app and paying the consultants and
So you're saying it's going to take you 2 years to develop your app?
No, it takes no. So what we're saying is when we develop our app, we'll be developing.
I'm sorry, 1 second. Excuse me, are you keeping time, Ms. Pickering? No, I'm saying, so 7 minutes for the presentation, then 3 minutes for the Q&A. So it's important for you to let us know. Yeah. Okay, going back. So again, the question is, are you saying that it's going to take you 2 years to develop your app?
No, so what we're saying is that we're going to take loans and then develop the app, and then we're going to recruit that.
How long will it take you to finish the development of that?
At least a year.
At least a year.
Mm-hmm. And so then after your app is developed, after year one,
yes,
you're going to turn it on and start marketing it and having mm-hmm. people use the app.
Yes.
So then when do you start generating revenue?
Revenue or profit?
Revenue.
Revenue is the second year.
Revenue. What is revenue defined as?
It's how much money we're bringing in.
Exactly.
So we would get our revenues in the third year.
Revenues?
We're starting our revenues within 6 months to a year.
Right, okay.
So yeah. So you're going to take, your app is going to be completed in between 6 months and a year then, right?
Yes.
And so then after the app is complete, and then how much on a monthly basis will you start generating from your app?
It's going to start with the ads. It's going to start with the ads at
$180 per month.
And then whoever is using the app to sell their books, they will be charged that transactional fee per.
And how many people do you expect to be using after the first month? Again, these are questions that you're going to be needing to kind of think about going forward. But again, you want to think about, well, how much money, again, your assumptions. And this is, remember, as we did that project about developing your financials, it was about this right here. Your financials really drive your entire presentation.
Okay.
How you get to there mm-hmm. is what your presentation is, okay. right? How much money are you going to need to get started?
Mm-hmm.
How are you going to raise that money? How much money are you going to start generating when your project is ready? And how you meet your assumptions? Like what percentage of the market are you going to be able to achieve? Okay. How are you going to accomplish obtaining that market share? Those are the things that a investor wants, and most importantly, when I can get my money back,
okay.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what an investor wants to hear, and that's what the presentation, for everybody's purposes, that's what your presentation should provide.
Okay.
Nevertheless, we'll go ahead and conclude right now, and we'll announce the score at the end, all right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Next group.
Thank you.
We didn't pull up our slides. Which one is ours? I don't know how to do this.
Just go down a PowerPoint at the bottom?
Yeah, I did. None of them are.
Did you have a PowerPoint or Word document?
A PowerPoint. We had both, actually.
Is that?
Something
that's our
plan.
Business plan.
Did you ask for it on the...
What team is this?
Team 2,
right?
Yeah.
Final five at the bottom right here. below business plan on the document, bottom five.
Oh, that one right there. Gotcha. Thank you. All right, Ms. Pickering, I'm sorry. Ms. Pickering?
I got you.
7 minutes,
guys. Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
Just please make sure you announce the time so we can also hear it, all right?
Sure.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Chanel Powell, and we are Skin.
My name is Tony Mathis.
Mishu Momo.
Tadion. Why Skin? Skin stands for Successful, Kind-Hearted, Intellectual Next Generation.
Our mission of Skin is to bring awareness of the American caste system to individuals through fashion, marketing, IT services driven by
philanthropic
foundation. Okay, team roles. I'm the CEO/sales marketing. Janelle is the vice president and she does research and development. Mishu is the COO in the production, and Todd Young is the CFO. These are our prototypes of the shirts. This is our signature logo right here. And this is our
slogan.
Our slogan.
Mm-hmm.
Target demographics. Our target audience is between 18 and 35. Fairly, that's definitely where we can do our most impact. All races, all genders. Obviously, the state of Maryland, DC, Maryland, Virginia area. College students. These are kind of like the basic survey questions we did. We basically asked age, economic status, did people know about the caste system, which we were very surprised not many people knew what the caste system was. Some people said they had heard it, but they didn't really go deep into it. Somebody said it was something with discrimination. That's what all I kept hearing. America, did they have a caste system? A lot of people believe they did not, depending on race. We had a lot of Caucasians that said there was no caste system. A lot of people of color said there was. This is the other survey we went into. This one's a little bit more in-depth. Actually, there's no slides. This one's good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm basically asking a little bit more in-depth questions.
All right, the products and services that we offer is an IT-integrated clothing software that provides people with a fashion sense who don't have one inherently. We found out that a lot of people really don't know how to dress. And if we incorporate our message into something that people have to do, which is wear clothes, we found out it's very effective. You can walk down the street and somebody sees the back of your shirt that says, "I am not my skin," they're gonna automatically be intrigued about the product and service that you provide.
Our business formation, we're an LLC corporation. Our corporation is a structure in which entails that both is a combination of sole proprietorship and partnership. Some of the assets that we have, some of the advantages we have is the protected assets. LLC provides limited liability protection to the owners, meaning that creditors cannot pursue the personal assets of owners to pay business debts. Pass-through taxation. Heightened credibility, knowing the fact that we're impacting the community. If someone is wearing our shirt, we'll get more publicity through that. We have few restrictions in the LLC, too. Disadvantage of becoming an LLC business, any act of partnership. Sorry.
4 minutes.
Now, restriction process. Formation of ongoing expenses. To form an LLC, articles of organization must be filed with the state and the application state filing fees paid. Transferable ownership That means that often it's harder to transfer with another corporation. With corporation shares or stock can be sold to increase ownership. Last proceedings, next. This is the a copy of a form, the article of organization, and also the limited liability company operation agreement.
And we also did a case study between our company and organizations such as Jack Threads and H&M. We found out that where Jack Threads fell short was when they decided to send out their customers their products before they actually paid for it. And that caused the business to lose revenue and profits during their time of production. Jack Threads was established as a men's online clothing shopping club by Jason Ross in 2008. And there he was able to start a growing corporation.
All right, this is the H&M, the revenue. As you can see, they started in 2012 with $120 billion, and they grew up to that. The cost of goods sold were based, we based our own projections and revenue projections through H&M because Jack Threads did not have a specified income statement online. These are the expenses. As you can see, the equity of the business. Projected and current revenue. During 2010, the three of us had bought Jack Thread for only, and they made over $5 million in revenue. All right, expenses. Man on our retail Jack Thread looking for a buyer now. And also, Recode reported that e-commerce site started as a flash sale model.
And we also knew that to start a business, you have to find out ways to monetize. These are some of our people that we've actually reached out to and see if they were interested in. We've asked fellow faculty members of Bowie State University, and it was something they was really interested in. We also created a GoFundMe page where we're able to publicize our mission and what our, we haven't raised any funds yet. However, we do believe that our product has a lot of potential. Also with Walmart, I'm affiliated with them. And I found out that they do have a program to bridge the diversity gap between Walmart and HBCUs. One of our fellow peers here is a member of this fraternity, so that we know that they offer their support. And the NAACP has ongoing support for many African-American businesses.
Our starter budget, how we came up with that was that we're projecting to start with 12 employees and pay them about $1,200 within the first month. And that would project to a one-time cost of $30,000, and that's within a year. As you can go down, we see that our supplies, we're going to be spending more money in the advertising, and also...
Hands up.
Okay.
How many slides do you have left?
We have...
Not very many.
Not very many.
No, I'm asking how many?
About probably five more.
I know. Uh-oh. Okay. Let's just go to questions and answers.
All right, well, thank you all for listening to our presentation.
Thank you. Yeah, that's great, guys. All right, 3 minutes for questions starting.
Thank you, Magdalena.
I hate to say this. I really didn't understand exactly what your business does because right now I didn't really understand it because it went so fast for me. But also, I just want to know your research about H&M because you did say started 2012. I know H&M since I was a kid. Maybe I used to live in Europe.
No, it started in 1900s. It didn't start in 2012. I'm saying our revenue projection started at.
So, I mean, it seems like very interesting to me, but who is your target? In a business, when you get to the business, your target should be broad. So what is your plan? Are you planning to stay with age range 18?
We're starting in a local
35,
area.
35? Or is just like this is open for everybody? Because if I go for 18, 35, I'm just so limited. So growth probably would never happen. That's my concern.
Okay, we understand that. And we are in the developing stages of that whole concept. Professor Kareem asked us to go on campus and focus, have our focal point kind of be geared toward campus activities and campus students because it's going to be incubated at Bowie State University. So that's really why our target market, it was to appeal for a younger audience. And we found out that a lot of the students here fall between the ages of 18 to 35. So that's the reasoning behind why we chose that demographic.
I was going to say on the demographic, I thought it was actually too large. I thought you should have focused on campus first and then talked about how many people on campus were in your market. So identification of your market would be, let's say, the entire campus community. What is the number of that?
We have that also.
And then, second of all, what is your percentage? How much of that do you all plan to get in year one, year two? And how do you plan, how much money do you plan to expend in order to obtain market share? Those are the key indicators that a good company will want to do. And I think what happened with you, you might have those in your deck, but you got you spent too much time talking about your business formation, like your LLC, and you know it was good to say that you were going to be an LLC and what an LLC was, but that was it. That needed to be like one sentence. You even showed us a sample of an LLC, you know, registration, which was totally not important. And it spent valuable time that you should have been using to really explain your numbers, which, again, you appear to have. And I think that, again, as Magdalena said, the H&M reference was totally not understandable by me either.
I'm not going to take up your time. The presentation was well put together, but like she said, I was a bit confused about what really the business was about. Maybe we were going a little too fast. I don't know. And then, are you a LLC or LLP? Both? I don't know.
Because there was a reference of LLP. It was inside the deck.
And then, you know, the target audience, I thought it was a little too large, but overall,
thank you.
All
right. LLP is a partnership. LLC is a
PowerPoint.
Yeah, PowerPoint.
But that's Team 2.
All right, Ms. Pickering.
How should 7 minutes
carry story now? All right. I'm Jonathan Jackson.
I'm Lorenzo Young.
My name is
Terry's not here. And the name of our business is called Simply Sane. This is our business logo right here. And as a startup business corporation, our overall concept is to provide our innovative wheelchairs to disabled people who are dependent on others to get around. We promise to revolutionize mobility for millions of wheelchair users and change lives while doing so. Our clip-on part will be produced with top quality and able to create a smooth surface for situations like going up and down the stairs. Our wheelchairs will have a joystick-based control option that will be installed, and it will be portable and battery-operated for electronic purposes.
So, yeah, so this is our demo graphics. Yeah, you already said it, but yeah, again, battery-operated, portable, and steps. In our market research, is a global market for for wheelchairs, and it's a forecast to reach about over 10 million people by 2020. And a key factor about driving growth in the market is to increase the productivity and, you know, the lifestyles disabled people live, and you know, to implement an equal opportunity for them.
By our research and insight, we noticed that here in the U.S., there's a rise in spinal cord injuries. There's a demand for power wheelchairs, and the aging population and susceptibility for disabled people are growing. Some of the competition that we have is Pride Mobility, Invacare, Drive Medical, Sunrise Medical. They are all companies and corporations that sell wheelchairs all around the globe.
So, you want to?
The survey questions that we have are, do you have a disabled family member? If so, does he or she feel more independent with a wheelchair? How often do you assist them with their everyday activities? Do you believe the wheelchair step planner will make a positive impact on their lives? Do you know what the ADA stand for? Do you feel like people with disabilities are discriminated against?
So, so we surveyed about 17, and 70% of them said that they do have a disabled family member. 29% of them said he or she feels more independent. They do feel more independent with a wheelchair. 41% said no. 70% said, how often do they assist? So 70% of them said that they do need assistance every day. And about 30% of them said no. 64% of them said that they do believe that a wheelchair stair climber is a positive impact on their lives, while 35 of them said they didn't know. And for the people who we asked if they know what ADA is, 23% of them said no. 77% of them said yes. 77% of them said no. 23% of them said yes. And 95 of them said that they do feel that they are discriminated against in the workplace. So we are a benefit corporation.
I got this one. We are a for-profit corporation expected to make a positive impact on society. Our purpose is to help handicapped families have an alternative wheelchair that is more beneficial and easy to use. We provide the best mobile access for people who are handicapped. The society environment will become more aware of handicap access in places because our stair climber is recyclable, 100% recyclable. We take full accountability for our business to have a material positive impact. Our benefit corporation is good because we will determine our impact based on the needs of our shareholders and customers.
So about our GoFundMe, this is it's an example because we were still in like in the development stages about figuring out our finances, our budget plans. So we just came up with like our startup costs, which were $250,000, like our for our revenues, and that's the cost of one product, one wheelchair is $1,500, and that's it. That's
And then for our promotional startups, what we plan to do is to create a Facebook account, Twitter and Instagram account with the name of Symphony Sane. And what will be promoted is the link to the GoFundMe account to raise funds for our startup goals.
Just curious, how did you come up with the wheelchair phrase?
I just came up with it because I have a couple, you know, I had a couple of family members that, you know, used it. And just, you know, my great grandmother, we just, you know, it was just like, it just came back to my memories, you know, how we used to treat them or whatever, how we used to assist them a lot when I was younger. So it just came back to my mind. You know, I was like, this is a perfect idea. So, you know, why not just, like, you know, talk about, you know, make it into our little
related
business.
Related to your grandmother.
Yeah. So.
That's nice. I like your business description.
Yes.
Makes sense.
if I could, I think that you guys also kind of confuse revenue versus cost. Here you said your revenues were $250,000, but then you said your costs also $250,000. I don't see, at least in your deck, you didn't show what your actual startup costs were, unlike the other team. And I see you had a copy in the handout, though, of at least one page of, or two pages of revenue projections, but the text is so small it's difficult for me to read. That might be something definitely you want to include on a deck. I do appreciate your reference to the mission, and just for the other judges, one of the things that this particular presentation sought was not only, again, a company that could generate a profit, but would also address something that the class has been discussing since the beginning of the semester, and that's this whole idea of the fact that racism here in this country is amount to a caste system. And so in this presentation, apparently, they are seeking to eliminate the caste system by creating equity between people who don't have mobility. So, but you guys didn't really, you know, hit on that connection as, I think, succinctly as did the team two before you. They definitely talked about, you know, how that mission was accomplished through their brand.
Well prepared, I can tell you that. But my little concern is this exists. This innovation is not really new. So when you start a business, you want to be different. You want to start something new, but this, as I know, already exists. So I would touch about helping the community by, you know, Medicare can accept it. You can go on and on talk about it, but right now this one is already exists. So what makes you so special? That was the only concern that I have. Other than that, the just welcome.
All right. Thank you very much.
Good job.
Thank you.
Hi guys. Here's our packet. Here's your packet. Hi, I'm Jack. Nice to meet you.
Hi, guys.
First off, I want to apologize for my attire. You know, it's not really an excuse, but I just really forgot today.
All right. My name is Jackie Pickering.
I'm Jason
Prince. I'm Shay Turner.
And we are from Dewey Bookshare LLC. So our roles is I took on being CEO. Shay was our operations manager, did all the day-to-day tasks, and then Jason's our accountant.
All right, I'll start. Our social impact was to get Bowie students to save more money with the concept we came up with. So our target demographic was students here at Bowie State, including our potential customers, such as new students and transfer students. How would this work? Students would pay out of pocket for the books. We had an issue trying to figure out if we wanted to do ebooks, which are online, but according to our surveys, which we will get to throughout the presentation, you will see that more people chose to get the paperback books.
All right. Also, we will offer payment plans if students are unable to pay the full price for the brand of new books or rent them. We will give them the opportunity to make a minimum of 2 partial payments. Also, make a down payment and pay the rest within 30 days of rental or purchase. Also, how we'll make it proper. There will be no minimum wage. We believe we won't be able to benefit from it. Also, for example, if one book costs $125, let's say about 80 students purchase that book, that's $10,000. Divide that by 4. Broke down into $2,500 for each of us.
What do we expect? We want students to feel more financially secure and feel like they won't have to come out a boatload of money out of pocket. In other words, we don't want them to feel overwhelmed or as if they couldn't afford to get the books they need for their classes. And this is our survey chart, what I mentioned before previously. The question was, do you rent or buy textbooks? And majority of our students said that they rented textbooks. Few of them said they buy new, and it was in between with buying used books.
And your next slide. This one. We all the groups over the LLC, so we did choose to be an LLC, so we're gonna kind of skip over what that means since our other groups have done it. So we did our case study on Chegg, and what Chegg is a book provider, and they also provide like studying methods and tutoring to students. So we took a lot of our numbers from Chegg, because we know we're not as big as them, because we're starting off at Bowie State University, and eventually go regional, because they're also worldwide. So we took some of our numbers from them, just estimating it where we would be in the budget. So this is our budget. Finding budget. So basically what we need to start. A lot of these numbers are based off of Chegg's and nowhere to be as big. So And then this is our startup budget. Being a new business, we make sure we follow our startup budget very closely, we don't overspend in the wrong areas. Because most companies fail in the first 3 years. Due to financial problems. So you can skip this one. This is our profit projection for the first 3 years. As I said, a lot of our numbers are based off of what Chegg has done, and we're just a smaller version. But our job is to make it, the purpose of our company is to help students and eliminate the caste system in the community by making our product available to everyone while also hiring off based off qualifications and not race, age, gender, religion. So how we plan to raise money, by using social media to connect with various students around the country. Also got a partnership, hopefully with Chegg had a partnership. So open the door to getting books. Always increase our funds. Students all over the United States will connect to our company over the years. Students really have a hard time buying expensive textbooks. Therefore, creating this outlet and option for students will benefit the company and students in the long run. So how we plan to compete with our competitors is We thank you. We're gonna say that we have the best prices, so that's kind of our goal. We know that we can't be the best, but that's what we're gonna go for.
Creating our marketing event, students love to feel like they are a part of something bigger than school. So we felt as though Bowie Bookshare will build a feeling of excitement and encourage others to rally with the company. with the company at various lunching parties and even book donations. This kind of project will create more of an emotional connection to the students and people that will invest in our company.
And 7 minutes.
All right, can we just go over our mission statement just so you guys have an understanding? To remove the caste system entirely from our society, Bowie Bookshare LLC has been created has been created as a book-selling company to help students of all race, sex, religion, and gender to buy or rent textbooks affordable to help students excel in the classroom and succeed after graduation. So, and this is our GoFundMe page. Yeah, so.
We didn't raise any money, though. Her mom donated $10.
It went to the thing.
But this is everything.
Yeah.
I'll start. So, apparently you did raise some money. I mean, you raised $10. That's more than any other group thus far we've seen raised. So don't, you know, undersell yourself, right?
Okay.
But I don't see here how much you're trying to raise. Well,
it says $10,000.
Okay.
So you're trying to raise $10,000.
Yeah.
Raise ten. Okay. Where is the show that you actually raised? Does this show exactly how much you raised?
No, that just tells you on GoFundMe.
Okay.
It's
like
the little bar moves your goal for every time, like you put money in.
Okay. I'll go with my colleagues. You want to go?
Again, I'm going to say the same thing that I say to the other students. Bowie Bookstore has the same idea.
But the Bowie Bookstore is overpriced. So
yeah,
we want to make it affordable for students because, I mean, I know an accounting student, one of the guys in the basketball team, spent $1,000 on textbooks. And that's ridiculous because, like, a lot of us can't afford that. Like,
I think what she's saying is that you needed to state what you were going to do different from the Bowie Bookstore in terms of if the Bowie Bookstore was selling books, for you said, for $1,000, and your presentation say, Bowie Bookstore, this is our competitor, and this is how we're going to basically beat our competitor by undercutting, you know, him.
Okay, I guess, and we can explain it throughout the week, throughout the actual whole semester. I think it's just a lot to put everything we did all semester into 7 minutes. So.
I like the payment plan idea. I don't know any other website that does the payment plan.
Yeah.
I was going to say this is a bit similar to check, but then the moment you said payment plan, I was like, okay, there's your difference. But what are your prices for the books? Like,
well,
what's
it basically
going to make us want to buy your books versus check? Because check is known.
Yeah, so basically it'll depend on the book we get and how much we paid for it. But we definitely make our prices better than all our competitors.
So it's going to be cheaper than
every
website.
Yeah.
Also, I saw on your financials that your main thing, again, going back to everybody, is a lot of your companies have to do with basically a platform, such as an app, for example. And the way in which you obtain customers is through marketing. That's your main expense. And so you should be dedicating, the amount of money that is necessary in order for you to actually obtain your customer. If $15,000, for example, if you're projecting millions of dollars worth of revenue is a insufficient allocation of your budget, right? So those are the types of things you want to think about. Exactly how much money do you need to spend to obtain every customer? And then basically grow that based upon the number of customers that you're projecting to obtain your market share, right? So that's the way the market share connects to your presentation. That's it. Thank you.
Yeah.
holding it up. I don't know how to work a teacher's blackboard. It's in blackboard.
Oh, you submitted something?
Yeah.
Do you guys have it on your
We know that we asked you to change your cord. That's the answer. How you doing?
Hi, how are you?
What time is it, Ms. Pickering?
It is 7:15.
Why don't we, while you guys pull up yours, why don't we go ahead and go to Team 6? Since they have it, go ahead. We'll give
you. Currently 7:16.
7 minutes starting now.
Who's watching? Who's watching?
Afternoon. We are called Small Park Innovative Parking. My name is Sierra Gladden.
I'm Ariel McCain.
I'm Lena Miller.
As you can see, here's our roles: Sierra Gladney, Chief of Sales and Marketing; Ernie McCain, Chief of Financial Officer; Lena Miller, Chief Diversity Officer; and Brianna Sharp, Chief Executive Officer. What is Smart Park? Smart Park is a parking system at Bowie State University, which is a guidance indicator of space administration, which provides drivers real-time data on the number and location of open spaces available in each parking lot on campus. The guidance indicator will consist of monitors located at the beginning of each parking lot, displaying the number of vacant and occupied spaces. The detection of vacant spaces would display a color green sensor and red for occupied spaces. Each parking space is structured with installed pneumatic road tubes that will sync with the display monitors for detection. Pneumatic road tubes detect vehicles via the air pressure created from the cars. The process would then close a switch, producing signals when the vehicle passes and stops over the tube. It offers a less cost solution as well as quick installation and easy maintenance.
So this is just our partnership agreement, basically stating that we are a limited liability partnership. I'm sorry. So this is the proof of market, basically stating the advantages of our system, basically like less parking time, so you have less time to find a parking spot. Also, it helps you protect vacant parking spots. A great advantage for Bowie State would be the fact that we can actually get to class on time versus riding around looking for parking.
Is for anybody age 17 and over that attends Bowie State or is a visitor here. You have to be driving to use the facility, of course.
Okay, so basically our market research shows that 61% of Bowie's parking spaces are for the students. I want to say around 32% are for faculty and staff. The rest would be visitors and or handicapped. The handicapped spaces, I think, are roughly about 3% of the parking spaces on campus. We currently have 2,204 parking spaces available, including the new structure for the nursing and science building.
This is our startup budget. Basically, for employee salaries, we already discussed this in a previous group venture. This is just our startup cost. We roughly started up with $700,000. That was our startup cost, right?
Our startup cost is $356,220. That's what it takes us to start the business. Next slide. This is a breakdown from what would be our projected income, our profit, and loss from 2018 to 2020. Next slide. Now, it's all about the money. I don't care how good you want something to succeed, you have to focus on how you're going to obtain the funding, how you're going to utilize the funding, and how you're going to make a profit. Based on just 2,500 parking space, my break-even point is $4.67 a month. We're charging the students $149 a semester. The first month, our income would be $447,000. From that, we only have to pay $11,667 for our investors, not counting the $120,000 for our salaries or some of the maintenance people. We will net a profit the first semester. This is an interest-free loan that we're looking at. The main thing I'm looking at is that within 5 years, that's two semesters, that's spring and fall, alone we can pay this off within less than 5 years based on the income that we're going to get by charging the students $149 a month versus the break-even point is only $4.67. So we're going to make our money. Next slide. This is just a graph of how the spring semester versus the summer is. You see, not too many people want to go to school in the summer. The fall semester, two sessions, and they basically break even, but that's how money you're looking at on the scale. We can make the money with the parking. It's there for us. Everyone loves to drive and come to school, so hey, we can do it. Excellent. And of course, this is our logo, Smart Park, the intelligent way to park, innovative way to park.
So this is our GoFundMe. It's actually a hyperlink to our GoFundMe account. We are also advertising on Facebook and Twitter. We have two pages set up for our venture. Hopefully it clicks through. Okay. Did it click? Okay. Okay, so this is our GoFundMe account. We currently raised $5 since the last time we spoke about it. So in the last 8 days, we raised $5. Basically, we have a goal of $70,000, which is 10% of what we actually need, which would be the $700,000. So we're looking for GoFundMe to raise 10%. The rest we are going to. Use a loan for. Get that down.
As we are new in the world of business, law and finance, so we have reached out to Mr. Rob Gramlich, who is our advisor. He just started a new business himself. There is no picture available for him. He is a member of the Linnekins.
Yes.
And we haven't set a definite date because, again, his schedule is conflicting with ours, with working in school, he working and whatever. I did talk with him one Sunday while he was at dinner, and he did commit to either help us focus on how to make this successful venture or direct us to the person or people that came. Thank you. Questions? Questions?
Any questions?
No. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
But
you have one?
To say?
No, go ahead.
All right. So I think that you guys had an innovative way of making money. It didn't necessarily, I didn't hear anything that tied into our overall mission. However, the key issue that I found was in your financials, and I don't know if you can pull them up. You said to us that you were going to charge students how much for parking per month?
$149 a month.
A month. Now, currently...
No, a semester.
That's what I heard you say, a month.
It's a semester.
Yeah, I heard you say a month, right? So that's what one of the issues. How much are students currently paying for parking?
$168.
$60. Hold on. How much are students paying per semester?
$60.
For the semester or the whole year? Right. Because I know, I mean, as a faculty member, I paid $40 a semester. So I was going to ask you, how are you going to get students to pay, again, almost 600% more than they're currently paying?
Okay. So it's broken down into tuition. So same way that we pay library fees or we pay gym fees, it's just going to be in your tuition. So you're not going to physically come out of pocket to pay it. It's just going to be a part of tuition.
Right. Well, again, my question is why would an administrator want to accept a parking, you know, system that you all are offering that's going to increase the cost to the students by 600%? Now, irrespective of how it's being paid, you assume, you know, again, that somebody can, like, for some students who have to pay for, you know, every dollar that they spend.
The administrator would look at the bottom line and would direct us, how will we get the other members to agree with our way of getting the increase, as you say, in school. Now, on the website, the police department has, campus release has the website, their tickets, the permits are $148. You pay $60, I didn't know that. I'm based on what the campus release is charging. And they are charging $148, so that's a conflict right there. As partners with Bowie State.
You said the parking passes that are being charged by?
By campus release, that's how I got my information
from.
So
you pay
$100?
I don't drive.
So
yours so would 40, you pay $149 a semester for parking?
Yes, because the amount of time I ride around this campus trying to park midday, I would. Because
did you guys interview students?
Yes, we did. We actually have a survey and we had a poll taken.
You have full-time students that come 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, they're here all day. Then you have...
Okay, I'm sorry. I apologize. Let's go beyond. But I think that those are some issues that came out of the presentation. I don't know if you guys did a good enough job about explaining why the venture, why the venture costs so much to the students, how much they're spending right now, and the benefit that you all are bringing to the students, which will outweigh their concern about the amount that it costs. But overall, but again, the innovation of your project was superior. So thank you very much.
Miss Pickering? Yeah, you gone?
It's 727.
Yeah. Yeah. Are you ready, Mr. Young? I'm good.
Yeah, I got you.
All right.
Good afternoon. We are RAD Career Development Center.
My name is Devonica Dobbins.
My name is Reginald Payne, and I believe Abigail is taking the final right now, so she cannot be with us. I am the CEO and the CFO.
And I'm the Chief Sales Officer and Chief Marketing Officer.
And Abigail is our Chief Technology Officer and Chief Diversity Officer. Brainstorming options, we came up with a textbook locker system. We also came up with a better, more hands-on career development center and a campus shuttle service. These are a few of our survey questions asking students what is the most common issue students face at the beginning of the semester, if there are any places to rent textbooks. Would you use it if there was a campus shuttle service to take you around the Bowie area? Would you use it? Our survey results showed that we had a decision to make between the textbook locker system and the Career Development Center. When we asked our initial 10 questions to 50 students, it was kind of leaning both ways. So we had to do another survey to narrow down what our choice was. But before that, go ahead, take a look.
So our audience has discovered that they actually prefer the Career Center.
There we go. Like she said, based off the last survey, we had to do another survey and ended up giving the students two different scenarios. One, if you have the choice between the textbook locker system or more hands-on career development center, which would you choose? The locker system allows students to rent textbooks. They pay a monthly fee of roughly $15, and you can rent a textbook for maybe 2-3 hours a day and then bring it back to the station and drop it off for the next student to use. And this was kind of like a segue to get students enough time to reach the amount of funds they need to actually buy the textbook for themselves or rent it from another source. And for the Career Development Center, we would be different from the current Bowie State Career Development Center, as we would get the students directly in contact with the businesses they're interested in, instead of having all these different jobs listed on a website that is very difficult to navigate. We get them like face-to-face contact, so it's a lot faster. These are the results from that second survey. 70% like the Career Development Center over the textbook locker system. Skip that. Good.
So as a team, we decided to go with an LLC because there was an equal amount of liability for each partner.
How many more minutes?
Initially concerned with how we would make money for the Career Development Center, and we decided to go with crowdfunding. And in addition to that, we would be using a nominal fee in Bowie's tuition, which would be around $25 each semester, so $50 a year.
And to piggyback off that, we were initially going to operate on a smaller scale from what the actual Career Development Center is right now, because they already have their budget, so we would just take whatever they were using and use it for ourselves and adjust our expenses accordingly. Like she said before, we were looking into potential crowdfunding sources like GoFundMe, AngelList, Rocket Hub, crowdfunder. We also have a Fundly account right now, as you'll see later on. But what we noticed from our research was Crowdfunder and Rocket Hub both seem to have the same type of support, where you have the business, where you actually have your, you build your own capital, and then you have investors kind of see what your business plan is, and they'll determine if they want to actually join in with you. And then AngelList was kind of the opposite of that. You get to see who your investors can be, and then you get to screen who you can have invest in your company. And AtBacker was, it was kind of like a plan B, just in case we don't get the amount of funds that we're actually striving for. Like I said before, we do have a Fundly account established right now. The link is at the bottom. Conclusion was that AtBacker was going to be, AtBacker partnered with Crowdfunder and Rocket Hub seemed like the way to go for us. When we looked at some of the Career Development Center's budgets, we saw that they had expenses up to $214,689. And for us, we were going to try and have startup costs, funds would be roughly $100,000, because we saw that, first we were going to be not as upscale as Career Development Centers.
So that means what?
That's time.
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 Time. Hey, you want to start?
I like the idea. I think it's a good idea because I still, with my own daughter, doing similar things. But I didn't see a financial analysis. The key things about business is the financial. That's the nucleus for your financial, but you didn't touch that part. Other than that, it's a good idea.
I do think it's a great idea, but I was looking for the financial part as well, too.
I think you guys spent way too much time. First of all, I think the there already is a business, a career center. But if you guys are able to do what you said you want to do, that will differentiate you from the career center. So that's a good thing. However, what needs to be distilled is, one, how are you going to sell this? Who are you going to be selling it to? So are you going to sell it to the university, or are you going to sell it to the students? So if you're going to sell it to the students, that means that you have to have an office, maybe near campus, that will be set up that will attract students. And then you're going to have to say, well, how much you're going to require the students to pay. Because if it's going to be, again, not sold to the university, that means that the students won't be paying through their campus fees. And so the idea of selling it, getting some money from recruiters, that's a way, but perhaps there might be another way, like a LinkedIn type of process where it's a free service, but then if you want certain additional add-ons, you pay. But overall, again, I think it's a good thing. So, class, hold up, wait. First of all, let's give everybody a round of applause. I really think that I could tell that everybody put in a good amount of work. Because of the time, what we're going to do is we're going to collect the input from the judges, and we're going to take it back, and we're going to make an announcement on the final, the day of final, so everybody will know what you did. So, again, study hard for the final. Knock them out. Please enjoy the refreshments. Come and talk to some of our judges. And again, let's give ourselves again a round of applause.